Ulrik Larsen, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Let's start at the beginning, because what happened was that you became a member of the North Korean Friendship Association in Denmark. Why did you do that?
Well, I needed something in my life, something interesting, and well, North Korea has a big could relate a bit to my childhood when I lived close to the border to Germany, and those countries were separated. And then I found out later in my life that, of course, North Korea was separated, but I will try to understand why people could support a regime like North Korea. And a simple Google search put me in for the Danish Friendship Association. And after two or three phone calls and a few emails, I participated in the first meeting. Well, then I took contact with the director, Mads Brøgger, and he made a documentary before about North Korea named The Red Chapel. And it was a crazy documentary and almost like a comedy. I asked him if he was interested in letting me infiltrate this friendship association, because I found it quite ridiculous and funny too. And he said, well, why not try and keep me posted? And during the next few years, I was getting a member of the board, having a lot of new comrades, which was quite older than me.
You advanced quite quickly. But I wonder, the first time you went there, was your plan to become some sort of mole already from the start?
Well, not like it ended out to be, but, you know, just try to film them in funny situations, defending North Korea and all those absurd stories you hear.
But tell me, I mean, what about your wife? You had to travel a lot with this new hobby of yours.
Well, I told her from the beginning that I found North Korea very interesting, and I would like to visit this friendship association to hear some stories and meet new people, just to try and understand the country. And then I told her that I could might visit the country if I had a camera with to show, you know, funny parts of it. And she was like, well, you're quite a nerd, so off you go.
This went on for more than 10 years. And a breakthrough moment is when you meet Alejandro de Benos.
Alejandro Cao de Bena is a Spaniard who has founded the KFA, which stands for the Korean Friendship Association. And he is the president of the association, and he has a lot of people all around the world which are named the OD, official delegates of a country or a region. And they could, you know, defend North Korea in the media or arrange meetings to tell the people about how fantastic North Korea is and, you know, make damage control. And as an Australian journalists once said, they are like useful idiots for North Korea, protecting the country. And when I met him, I met a Spaniard in North Korea in a North Korean military uniform, which is quite funny to watch, acting like a North Korean. And he was like the gatekeeper of North Korea, like he could choose who can come in and out from, you know, from the journalist side and for the travel and tourist side. And when he's in North Korea, he's really defending the country more than he even is outside. And then after I came back home from this first trip to North Korea, I spoke with the director that I think he could be a game changer for the whole plan.
You very much gained his trust. I mean, he's not here to defend himself today, but
no.
What part would you give him in this story?
Well, he's the supervillain. He's the one, as we call himself, he's the matchmaker who makes things happen. After I went to North Korea and met him, we had a lot of emails backward and forwards. And I then said to him, I have a weekend in Barcelona, and he lives in the area of Barcelona. Maybe he could want to meet up with me. And he came to my hotel and we talked 3 hours. And then he just said, Ulrik, if you want to be my official delegate in Denmark, it's yours. And of course, I would love to be that, because that could gain me even more trust in North Korea. And practically, I've been home for 3 or 4 days. I got the first email that if I knew somebody who would invest money from 50,000 euros to 1 million euros, we could do something. And that's really opened up the possibilities to show how North Korea is. And then the director came up with Mr. James, which is his real name is Jim Letras, and he's a fantastic person with an even more fantastic acting skill. And he knows the game because he has a past which is quite different from any other people. And he knows this game to play. Well, Jim has a history of being a cocaine jet set pusher in Denmark and spent 8 years in prison. And now is a legit businessman with a great business in Copenhagen.
But he's not as rich as he pretended to be.
No, not at all. But, well, the North Korean is under that much pressure. And since I got a medal from the regime in 2012, and Alejandro, which has a big star in North Korea, we just cleared him out for the North Koreans and put up the meetings between Jim and Alejandro in Oslo. And we didn't even use more than 2 minutes. Then Alejandro was literally just open up this magic box of weapons and methamphetamine, and everything is possible in North Korea.
This was your mission when you and Mr. James went to, or this actor who called himself Mr. James, when you went to Pyongyang, it was to set up some business where you could buy weapons and drugs.
Drugs, yeah. Early in the morning when we have got our breakfast, we sat in the car and drove outside of Pyongyang. And it was not the showcase city anymore. It was the slum area with really the buildings were literally falling apart. I was practically really nervous, a bit scared, because now we are in some areas where Western people never come, and people at the street were looking very strange of us. And when we went down this basement, it was like, okay, did somebody blow our cover, or did we blow it ourselves? But we were met with a big door with black leather and like golden strips on. And on the other side of the door, there was this luxury conference room with food all over, karaoke, singing girls, and it was like a party. And after the dinner, they just literally took like a menu card and said, here, this is what we have from weapons and tanks, everything, mass destruction weapons, Scud missiles. And then I asked, well, is it possible for me to take some pictures or some film so Mr. James can show his partners in Europe that we actually are here and we have achieved this meeting and so. And the North Korean was like, of course, you're a friend. Even at a point, they just took the camera out of my hand and started filming me in the group. And I was like, this is so crazy. Literally, are we going to be shot after this? Because now they're just playing us out. But no, they were believing 100% in us.
What side of your personality has been to your biggest advantage?
What was the best for me was I had a visit in Washington, D.C. with a previous CIA agent. And he taught me that to be a perfect mole or perfect agent, you need to be 95% yourself and 5% mole. Because don't lie too much, because it will be too difficult to remember all your lies. Tell them you have wife, you have children, you live in the suburb of Copenhagen. Give them your phone number, give them your email address. Going North Korea, you need to fill out your address at home. So they got my address at that point. But be honest, and just let this last 5% be your observation skills and the skills to open up the doors. And that helped me a lot, because I think when people today are trying to find out, they are too making things too difficult for themselves. If I should tell I wasn't having any children or no wife or I lived in another town, at one point I will make a mistake and then my cover would be blown.
I mean, this went far. You and Mr. James ended up doing a big deal about making a weapon factory. The deal is off, and everything is exposed now. North Korea, it should be said, is also denying everything that's been said here now. And I wonder, have you ever been worrying that they actually played you?
It's difficult to say, but I don't think so. I think actually they were into this business, but of course it's North Korea, and you don't hear any businessmen go out in public and say, hey, I got fraud by the North Koreans, because that would be really bad for their business in the future. But I think the kind of documentary that we came out with are showing how it's possible to do, and we got all the evidence to that, which also now led me to have an invitation from the United Nations as well to talk about what I achieved during these years.
Yeah. So you are invited to the United Nations to talk about this, but how about your wife? We could see in the clip before we started where you're actually telling her about what you've been doing for the last 10 years. And she called you an idiot. Has she forgiven you now?
Yes, you have. The funny part is, the day after I told her, she was not talking about it at all. But 2 weeks later, she was like, all her mind just started to come on. All the questions came out. And of course, she was mad at me because I didn't tell any. I was in practical in the danger of my life. But she now understands if I told her, she would be too worried when I was gone, or at least she wouldn't even not let me go out of the door anymore. But today she's proud of me and is still trying to, you know, to understand how I could be that kind of person for so many years.
What are you thinking, Björn?
Well, I have two things I'm really curious about. One would be just to hear a bit more, why did you do this thing? It's such an incredible adventure, such a dangerous thing. High stress, life-threatening situations you put yourself in year after year. And my second question is, what's your life like now? As far as when I read the news, North Korea seemed to be quite dangerous to make enemies with. They kill people outside of North Korea that are not nice to North Korea.
Well, the first question, well, as I said in the beginning, I miss something in my life, something exciting and trying to understand new things. But at that point, I was not even in my fantasy could think about something like this. If that was the way I went into this project, I think that Mads Brügger and Peter Engel, the producer, would say, this man is a maniac. But it advanced slowly and getting bigger and bigger, and then all the opportunities that Alejandro came up with was very interesting to follow. And to the second question, of course, North Korea is dangerous, but they don't have the history to try to hurt other people than their own nationality outside North Korea.
Right, right. Yeah.
And now, at the moment we have this COVID-19 virus, I think it will be quite difficult for North Koreans to go to Denmark. But of course, there's a lot of security around my person now. And I'm quite aware where I'm going, when I'm going, or if I'm going a new place, I normally check it out 2 hours before just to be sure that things looks normal.
Ulrik Larsen, tusen takk for at du var her I kveld. Takk til deg, Magdalena, og takk til deg, Bjørn. Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.